Hello, everyone who has joined us. Please just give us a few more minutes. We want to make sure everyone is logged in and we will begin our event. Welcome everyone to the AMA Atlanta virtual event, Making the Most of Seasonal Marketing Tactics. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Leanne Touchton. I'm with The Proven Method. We're a technology consulting firm, and I'm co-VP of programming for the AMA Atlanta. First, I'd like to thank our sponsors. Starting with Nebo, we have the Goodway Group, Hey Orca, Georgia Pacific Electric, Acquia, the AJC, CoxNet, Hot House, Vert, and Lucky. We also have Mercer and Google. So if you are interested in being a sponsor, feel free to contact Guy Powell at sponsorships@amaatlanta.com. Now I'd like to introduce to you our moderator. Her name is Noelle Jones. Noelle is a purveyor of culture. She's been a public relations manager for Fortune 500 companies such as Cricket Wireless and Southern Company. She has also worked for the High Museum of Art here in Atlanta. Noelle has been named Atlanta's top young professional in the Atlanta Tribune and a mover and shaker in South Fulton in Lifestyles magazine. Noelle, I'll give it to you.
Awesome. Good morning, and welcome. Thank you so much, Leanne. I am so honored to be here and talk about the power and potential of tapping into seasonality with brilliant marketers today. New and innovative approaches to marketing have been the cornerstone of this past year, with brands and organizations of all sizes tapping into unconventional approaches to reach consumers. We also know that finding reasons to celebrate moments in time, holidays, special seasons, they all enhance the audience experience and sentiment, which is why we're here today to discuss seasonal marketing. Our panel is outstanding. They come from diverse backgrounds and throughout their previous and current positions have played in the B2C and B2B marketing arenas, while also touching on and integrating seasonality. As we all explore innovative and fresh ways to touch consumers and customers, they are here for a conversation that will help us to unlock and consider ways in which seasonal marketing can truly help us accomplish this. I'll introduce our first panelist, Narcis Alekhani from the Atlanta Hawks. Narcis is the Director of Marketing for the Atlanta Hawks and State Farm Arena, where she's responsible for leading and developing and executing brand marketing strategies and activations. Prior to joining the Hawks, Narcis served as the Marketing Manager for Stone Mountain Park. We're so happy to have you today, thank you. Next up, we have Emily Conscious from Halco Lighting. Emily is a marketing professional experienced in fostering a creative environment, focusing on distribution and end users with results-driven leadership skills. She's the marketing manager for Halco Lighting Technologies, where she develops and implements marketing strategies for all sales channels to create brand awareness, demand generation, and drives sales initiatives. Thanks for joining us, Emily. Last but certainly not least is Christina Porter. Christine is an experienced marketer that has worked across a wide variety of industries, including flooring, telecommunications, consumer electronics, agriculture, and building materials. She is passionate about branding and digital marketing and loves learning new things. Originally from Mexico, Christina has lived in Georgia for the past 10 years, and she's also still looking for the perfect taco in the state. Thank you so much for joining us, Christina. Before we get started, I just want to invite everyone to drop any questions that you have throughout this webinar in the Q&A box. We'll reserve time at the end to make sure that we get any of those questions to the panelists before we wrap the event today. I will just kick us off with the first question. So I'd love to hear from all of you all. How have you and your organizations pivoted strategies to compete in a now more competitive marketplace with other brands now tapping into seasonality? Tell us how you guys have done it.
I'll go first. So thank you for having me. This is awesome. From our standpoint, we are more B2B focused. So we've always thought about the B2B side and relying on our customer to create that awareness to pull through with whatever promotion or campaign that we're working through. And now we've had to pivot and think more about the consumer. So when we do a promotion, we have to think of what incites the consumer and then help to create that awareness, not only through our customer, but also through the consumer. And that's done digitally through social media and promotions that drive some sort of sell through.
Awesome. Anyone else?
Yeah. So hello, everyone. Narcisse with the Atlanta Hawks. And for us, this has been the year of the pivot. And it's less about being competitive and competing for that entertainment dollar as we have been used to in the past. And it's been more about building the business back up. Obviously, we are an entertainment venue, and we have basketball games and we have concerts, and we haven't been able to do much of that over the past year. So building the business back up, pivoting, and really finding new ways to create value for our corporate partners and our fans. And that really required us kind of taking a look inward over the past 12 months and using our brand's North Star to guide our actions.
I agree with Narcisse, actually. It was really for us in Mahawk Group, it was a year of the pivot, definitely. What we had planned completely fell through. And actually looking at seasonality, it was very interesting because there were a lot of items that we ended up weaving into the narrative of our brand, looking at what the consumers are looking for. Our customers are, again, B2B as well. They're architects and designers, and they have very clear things that matter to them. So what we looked at was what mattered to them at this point and how can we provide them some value. So we pivoted a lot of how we went to market with, for example, CEUs or content that drove a lot more inspiration for them and provided that in a seasonal way. We looked at how we were approaching CEUs and provided more content for them, so more engagement. We actually went to CEUs that were weekly versus monthly or even every 3 months. And we also looked at how we could create content and move it to a cadence that was more regular as people were completely in their houses and they were looking at the virtual experience, right? So we actually looked at also what our seasonal really experiences look like and try to map out what we could do to supplant those. So for example, having a virtual event instead of having a trade show. Trade shows are really important for our industry. So we actually went back and created our own virtual event to do so. So there were a lot of changes and we tried to look at what their customers were doing, what resonated with them, and then created more content related to that and campaigns around it.
Super helpful. It's almost like the pandemic has forced and pivoted all businesses and organizations into this concept of seasonality and looking at what's going on and making sure that none of us are tone deaf to just what's going on in the world around us and what our customers and consumers are feeling, which leads me to the next question. And you guys kind of answered this, but if you can delve into it a little bit more, Have new seasonal opportunities been birthed from the pandemic? We know that there were so many different conversations happening in culture and in the world last year. And so are there ways that you all's organizations have tapped into those moments in time? And then what can those who've joined us today learn from that?
Sure, I can start that one. So in the sports world, sports is all about seasonality, right? So we know when basketball season starting and football season and baseball, and we have those memories associated to that time of year. And obviously that has been completely turned upside down over the past 12 months. And for the NBA, that meant, you know, ending the season early last March. It meant going to the bubble. It meant finals were in October when they're typically over the summer and draft in November. So everything was just different. And for us, that meant, you know, being a source of information where we were needed. But it also meant staying relevant in a time when we weren't playing basketball, but also there was a lot going on in the world. And as a sports franchise in the city of Atlanta, we feel it's our duty to show up for our community and use our assets to show up for our fans. And that meant around matters of social justice and using our assets to help create and inspire positive change by providing access to voting. It meant pivoting our traditional summer camp programs that we did and creating online and virtual offerings. And then when we finally got back to playing basketball in December, it was about bringing the conversation back to play and watching basketball on TV since you couldn't attend a game in December. And then it became, how do we deliver that in-game experience to fans virtually? And then how do we bring fans back to the building? So it was a very crawl, walk, run approach. And now the team is hot and it's about building it back up and leveraging that excitement as we gear up for playoffs and more people are getting vaccinated and we can get more people in the building. But specifically around the topic of social justice and civic engagement, it was a journey, but it was very exciting to be a part of. State Farm Arena became the first arena in the nation to become a voting precinct. And none of us had ever done that before. So it required a lot of learning and a lot of, you know, kind of applying what we do daily with sporting events and concerts and applying that operational knowledge to create the most efficient voting experience for fans. And we had over 40,000 people come through the arena and cast their vote for the election. And it was really awesome to be a part of. And for us, that really started with one, understanding what our brand is all about, and that's being true to Atlanta, and what did this city need? And we needed access to voting. And our ownership, you know, we're all very fortunate to work for an organization where from the top down, they understand that we're a community asset. And the building was sitting there and we couldn't have events. So why not use it to host voting? So definitely not on our typical path of what we would do in a season. But again, listening to that, your brand's North Star helped guide us there.
Awesome. Anyone else have to add to that?
Mine is not as exciting. Definitely. Yours is a lot more interesting and important, really, for not only the community, but the country overall. What I've also seen, and this is something that matters to all of us, is that we can always learn what is happening in the world outside of marketing and how it's a huge importance on how we go to market, how we're listening in to what matters and then responding. For us at Mohawk Group, it has been a lot about going back into the office. So now that everybody's gearing up to going back into and opening up all the businesses, how do we help our customers and our consumers to plan for that? We are looking at how we can help them design for social distancing and also social integration. We're looking at the built environment really as a driver of what can we help them do to make our transition back easier, more seamless, and lasting. So that is an interesting part. We are generating a lot of content related to COVID-19, how it impacts not only the part of cleaning and how everybody is maintaining spaces, the built environment, but also how we're designing for the future.
Awesome. Thank you, Christina. Emily?
Yeah, and mine again, mine sound exciting as for the Hawks, but for us, we had to think, ours is more centered around the pandemic. So during this time, what could we do to, one, all of our distribution was closed. They couldn't get people in the doors. So what could we do to help our distribution create some awareness? So we thought again about a different audience, an audience we've never captured before. So we wanted to give thanks to our healthcare workers, our first line responders, all those on that front line that were doing what they could during the pandemic. So we came up with a way to give almost like we called it wash the day away, because at the time I was with Hans Gray, we were selling plumbing. Why not have something that they could come home and wash that day away in a relaxing shower? So helping the distribution be able to have that conversation with a different audience that they probably would have never thought to capture. And it was a huge success, but it was more of a goodwill thing, but also none of our competitors are doing it. So something just different that we are trying to just think outside the box and be part of the conversation, just in a different way, a more positive way.
That's awesome. I think you all said some great things, and it's so interesting because traditionally seasonality is looked at as, you know, holidays or Valentine's Day and things like that. But I feel like so many brands have, COVID has become a season that we've all had to pivot to and try to understand even what our consumers and customers and audiences are going through. And so with that, what sort of research do you think that seasonal marketing should be grounded in? You know, what has been you all's approach to learning more about your audiences and consumers and customers to build those effective strategies, especially whether it, you know, relates to traditional seasonality or the pandemic? What was the process that you all went through to come up with how you would, you know, pivot those strategies to really reach your audiences and touch them in this time?
Right before the shutdown happened, we actually worked to build what we call our fan council. So a group of fans that opted in to just help us come to different decisions related to the fan experience, whether that's through surveying or attending a game and doing a focus group afterward. So we put this group together, and then immediately after everything shut down. So, you know, all the plans that we had to do research and learn more about our fans with this group were kind of thrown out the door. But what they did become for us is a group that we did surveys with on a regular basis, just to gauge their sentiment around COVID and their comfortability with coming back to live events. So we would ask them questions like, when would you feel comfortable coming back to a live event? In 3 months, in 6 months? And if you do come back, what do you want to see? What would make you feel safe? And we did that surveying, and it was interesting over time to see people's sentiment. And, you know, by month six, everyone was tired and they want to come to a game. So lucky for us, but obviously we've had to, you know, follow the CDC guidelines and kind of bring that back into place slowly. But definitely this group helped us in our rebuilding our business.
For us, it's very similar, actually. In the industry, we actually have a lot of third-party research as well. So we looked at third-party research to gauge what was happening with the industry. The industry got hit very much during the pandemic. So it did affect the business in general, but we wanted to also hear from our sales team. We constantly reach out to the sales team to listen to what they're hearing as well. They are our frontline with our customers, and they know their customers very well. They were continuously in contact with them, and we were in contact with them as well. We also started a lot of research directly with the audience. We had a series of interviews to learn about what we could do in the future. So we're future-proofing our business against this kind of really, you think, impossible situations, but that could happen, so that we know what matters to them, how we can help them, and how we can provide value. So there were a lot of streams of information that were coming in to into marketing, and we were kind of threading the water with those really streams of information.
Yeah, ours was the same with Christina. We really relied heavily on our sales team, our agents, our reps, and then also our customer, and just working with them to understand what can we do at this time to help create that awareness, help add that added value. And one thing from our perspective was being in the built like more building product space, seasonality was a little different. Like you still had your seasons, but everything's kind of blurred now because people are at home. So when a time where they might be replacing and updating their kitchen during the fall to get ready for the holidays, it's now right now in summer because they're home and they're cooking more. So for us, it was that change of, I want to call it blurred lines, because there's still seasons, but things change from the consumer standpoint because they were home all the time. So how can we help be part of that conversation, help get our, you know, our customer top of mind at the end of the day?
Awesome. Thank you all. I mean, I think that every marketer probably has tapped into some of those things, whether it be surveying, interviews, research. We're pulling out all the stops right now to really try to understand and for businesses to be successful in this crazy season that we've been in. With that, this is more of a creative question. Would love to know more about any new seasons that you guys have tapped into during this time where the world has changed and we've been home. Is it awareness days? Is it awareness weeks? Is it what unconventional seasons, aside from the traditional, if any, have you guys tapped into to really engage audiences? And Emily, I think you talked about some with some of the cool campaigns that you guys have done. Tell me a little bit more about that.
Yeah, from our perspective, it was, again, because of those blurred lines, how do we be part of conversation? So for example, we're getting ready to kick off a summer campaign because we know that consumers are home all the time. So they are now doing more activities in the house, outside the house. So doing a campaign where the consumer talks about us and summer lights under the nights is what we're calling it, but getting a consumer to post about being outside and our company, our lighting company, being part of that conversation. So now it's not so much of like getting ready for the holidays type of mindset. It's more, you know, it's summertime. It's people are wanting to be outside. So us being part of that with them, be part of that adventure, those memories that they're making.
Awesome. Anyone else?
I think the other weirdly seasonal thing for us, sustainability is one of the really core values for not only our company, but it's a really high importance for the customer. And what we've seen, not basically from the pandemic, but it has become more and more important. What we've seen with global warming and with climate change is impacting a lot. And this has really nothing to do with COVID, but it is very apparent. Once we were all shut down, the weather wasn't as hot. It was really interesting to see. But for Mohawk Group, the seasonality part is how it relates to sustainability. So for example, we recently launched a full campaign called the Waterworks Project, in which we are doing a hybrid approach to events with digital content and in-person when we can actually safely do it, but related to sustainability and how river health is human health. It is very interesting because sustainability, specific holidays for sustainability are really World Water Day, where we launched CEU. We have Earth Day coming up actually next week, where we are also having another CEU series. And we're really looking at the opportunities of taking advantage of that weird season, because it's not really, you can't really think about it as a season, but there is very marked days that where we all think about the health of the earth and how we're generating content that resonates with our customers and resonates with the world in general.
Absolutely. Oh, go ahead, Narcy.
Oh, I was gonna say, for us, not necessarily any new seasons, but more so tapping into different communities within our fan base and understanding their needs and helping meet them there. For example, with, you know, schools being shut down, most kids within the Atlanta Public School System get their meals at school. So we partnered with State Farm to create a meal pack program to deliver lunches to kids who aren't attending school. Things like our Lunar New Year celebration, unfortunately, this year turned into, not only partnering with the Asian and Pacific Islander community to celebrate Lunar New Year, but then also addressing, you know, a big thing going on in the world right now with Stop Asian Hate. So partnering with different groups within the Atlanta community to figure out what needs are there and meeting them there. So, you know, I think it's less about finding different seasons, but different moments for us where we could step up and help.
I love that. I think all of those are so inspiring. Even, I mean, summertime is a great time to tap into. Everyone is going to be trying to go outside, but also you're right, Christina, the concept of sustainability really is kind of a common thread now, especially because the world has changed so much. And then most certainly Lunar New Year. So I know that our audience can probably, some light bulbs are going off about potential campaigns they may be able to launch. Narcisse, my next question is going to be specifically for you. If you can just talk to me a little bit about the seasonal marketing campaigns that the Hawks has done. And I know that really basketball season is a thing within itself. And you've talked a little bit about how the season has changed. But talk to me about the new marketing strategies that the Hawks, or the new approach to marketing that the Hawks has taken in this season. Why do you think that this new approach was effective, or that these strategies have been effective? And what can attendees of this panel who are in a similar industry like live and sporting events learn from this new approach that the Hawks took in this season?
Yeah, I think this season we were really challenged to connect with the community and our fans in a different way. So community became very important to us, and that was because of, you know, what our brand is all about and what our executive leadership is all about. Also, you know, being mindful and aware of what's going on in the world around us and being nimble there and empowering our team members to be nimble there, but also creating that framework to where they'd be comfortable. So, you know, identifying our content pillars when it comes to social, empowering our team to come up with, you know, new and fun ways to engage with our fans, but also, you know, double checking it, because our content can have unintended consequences based on what's happening in the world at the time. Staying true to our brand and true to Atlanta, and then really taking the crawl, walk, run approach has been our North Star during this entire time. So when we started the season in December, traditionally, you know, that comes with a big, exciting opening night and you're inviting the whole city to come out. Well, we didn't have that. So it was more like, okay, you know, tune into the game at home, and then finding new ways to bring that fan experience home. So for instance, our annual HBCU night, it's a fun night where, you know, different schools and alumni come out and celebrate this night with us. Well, we had to extend that virtually this year. So what we did was a pregame panel that fans that couldn't attend the game could kind of get a glimpse of what was going on. We did a clubhouse event. Clubhouse has been big for us in finding, you know, new ways for our fans to connect with us on social. We did a virtual post-game DJ party where, you know, fans who weren't at the game could, you know, log on IG Live and see DJ Big Tigger. So just, you know, finding ways to be relevant and bring that experience that, you know, fans are traditionally used to getting in the arena home.
That's awesome. And HBCU night, I know, is a beloved night, even for me as a Howard graduate. So just quick follow-up to that. Are there certain seasons within basketball season that resonate most with your fan base? Are there things that you found where you guys have more engagement, more social chatter, et cetera?
Yeah, so I think definitely the start of the season, which kind of coincides with the start of football season as well, that's a very exciting time for us, and it naturally leads into the holidays. traditionally Black Friday is a big ticket selling and retail selling time for us. Obviously we didn't have tickets to sell this year, so it turned more into retail. And then the NBA has a number of key tentpoles that kind of go throughout our season. So Hispanic Heritage Month is at the very start of our traditional season. And then going into Atlanta Pride, we've been big in the Atlanta Pride Parade every year. Obviously this year it was virtual. I talked about Lunar New Year, Black History Month, and then Women's Empowerment and History Month. So these are all kind of key tentpole NBA initiatives that we've had to figure out how to celebrate virtually this year.
Totally. And I know the virtual experiences have still been memorable. I've even just heard about them in the social chatter that's going on around them. I want to flip to Christina and Emily and let's talk B2B. So the simple and first question is, how does seasonality play into your communications and marketing strategies in the B2B world? What would you tell all the B2B marketers who are looking for new ways to tap into that space?
I can start. So I think it's interesting, but I do think that it depends. Seasonality depends very much on the company and your audience. So you have to plan accordingly to what matters to your audience related to seasons versus what and weave in your brand's narrative and your what is important for your company. In some of my previous jobs, for example, seasonality wasn't related to holidays or dates. It was more related to the seasons of the year. I was in an agriculture equipment company, and how we planned all our communications had to be hyper-personalized to that seasonality and to that agriculture practice, to that segment-specific audience. If you didn't make sure that, for example, you had a photo shoot of a tractor of a certain size in the snow with a plow, then it wouldn't resonate, and you would release it in winter, then it would just flop. You would have to make sure that you were being hyper segmented on all of the assets. Not only the copy related to the pain points of each one of that specific segment of audience, but also the imagery and how you went to market with the promotions, making sure that the implements were right at the time. For things like nowadays with Mohawk Group, A&D, our architects and designers, it depends on what is important for them and where they reach out to the brand for. We know inspiration and sustainability are key for them. So we generate seasonal content related to that. We create palettes of the different swatches of products that are related to, for example, fall or specific to a day. We link back to other industry important dates. Like for example, when Pantone releases its color of the year, we definitely do a mood board related to that. So there's multiple ways where you can really listen to what matters to the audience and make sure that seasonality is embedded into that in a smart and creative way as well. So it doesn't have to be about holidays, which is the fun thing, but also related to what that season means in terms of the year. As Narcisse was saying, Hispanic Heritage Month for me is super important because I come from that culture, and culture was very relevant on how we saw seasonality as well. In, for example, in Sony when I used to work there, Mother's Day was super important in Mexico and for Latinos. So we knew that we needed to do huge promotions related to that, and we had to make sure that everything resonated with the audience.
Yeah, and just to add on to what Christina was saying, everything she said is so valid and so true, and everything that I apply from my perspective as well. The other side was also understanding our customers. So from the B2B side, what is the customer's busy time? And during, is it during seasons, as in Christina was saying, as in, you know, summer, winter, et cetera, or is it around holidays, and then developing some sort of campaign or promotion to be part of it? And then on the flip side is some customers already have promotional calendars built up. So for example, I had a customer that had a promotional calendar built up for literally every season. So one, being part of that conversation within just having our products part of the promotion, but then providing them the content, the assets, what they needed, so we can be part of it and they could talk about from their perspective. So it's both parts of it.
Awesome. Thanks to you both. We actually have a couple of questions from the audience. And so I'm going to pivot over to those just to make sure we have enough time to get them all answered. So I'm going to start with a question from Scott. Thank you, Scott. The question, I believe, is for all of the panelists. Do you think you gained any experience from the pandemic that you will keep even after the pandemic is over? Any marketing practices that you think will stay that you knew were an option? So the simple question, do you think you gained any experience from the pandemic around marketing that you'll continue? Any new marketing practices that you gained that you'll continue in your organizations?
Yeah, I can, I'll go first. So from our perspective, as we're B2B, we had to start thinking again about the consumer. So when I do a promotion or some sort of campaign, I didn't just work with one channel on the distribution side and thinking about the B2B, I worked on all channels. So it was more of a cross-channel promotion and doing more of like having what I did in the distribution, same thing online from the e-com standpoint, because I knew that would create that awareness to the distribution. So it went from a channel-based mindset previously before the pandemic. And yeah, there was still some consumer thought, but this push that mindset even quicker than where it probably would have been maybe in the next couple of years. So really starting to think of not so channel focused, more cross channel, and then thinking about the consumer, even from a B2B standpoint.
That's awesome. Anyone else?
I think for us, we really learned the lesson of scalability. So going virtual allows you to reach more people. So just a small example of that, it was time for us to gear up for our summer camps programs last summer. We couldn't have them in person. So we transitioned and created Hawks at Home, which was a virtual offering. So where we would use to take 200 kids through a summer camp program in 1 week, we started doing a virtual class every Thursday where 1,000 kids could join. So I think we've learned that we shouldn't always have that in-person mindset, although we all love community and being around people. But also there are ways you can grow your brand and scale virtually.
Agreed. Actually, I call it the hybrid approach. So for me specifically, I'm completely digital driven. Right, I've been in digital for the last 15 years, and digital is core for me. And the importance of digital became imperative. So really future-proofing your business in terms of having that digital experience ready to go out, expanding that engagement and your reach with not only the in-place experiences, but really that digital experience, that virtual. That was core for us, and that's something that's going to continue. How do we provide value in a digital experience that is the same or very similar to what they could experience in a place? My industry is very tactile, so getting to that point is a challenge, but there's so many avenues that you can reach, and there was a lot of innovation. And I think that's the other part that I think it's super important out of the pandemic, is always continue innovating. You can't really sit and say, oh, this is great, this is what we're gonna do every year. You really can't do that. You have to continue innovating and future-proofing for the future. That's super repetitive, but.
No, 100%. I mean, what I was going to add is that we're only going forward, not backwards. And so from a digital standpoint, we all are going to be challenged to think about what is going to be the next thing. You know, how can we tap into these new, whether it's social channels or digital landscapes and experiences? I also heard scalability, which is so important as well. The next question is specifically for you, Narciss. With COVID-19, how did the Hawks adapt to times we're going through with their marketing? And I think you talked about this a little bit, but do you have anything to add around that you haven't already shared around how you all adapted?
Yeah, I think, you know, we had to adapt in different ways, and it was mainly centered around being relevant at a time when we weren't playing. And then when we were playing basketball, how can we extend that experience to fans when we couldn't have them in the building? And I think the lesson out of all this is just learning to be nimble, and then, you know, really understanding your brand and what your brand is all about to help you guide those decisions.
Thank you. Awesome. The next question that I have here is, I have quite a few. Okay, so the next one is, and I think this is for everyone, how, if at all, do you think the needs and desires of your audiences are changing since the pandemic? What excites you about this opportunity? I know that's one we kind of threw in there, but the needs and desires of your audiences and your customers, how are they changing, or how have they changed since the pandemic? And again, I think some of you guys kind of spoke on this, but anything else to add, and what's exciting about that?
I can start with that one. I think more than anything is how, again, the audience, my audience is architects and designers. Time is so important for them. The projects, they need to be done pretty quickly. So every second counts. And that has been a big difference. So what we've seen is a reduction of time that our audience has to waste time, not to waste time, but to meet with our sales teams. They are really tired of being virtual. So things that were working 12 months ago or 10 months ago are no longer working. That is a challenge, that everything that we knew is constantly changing, and the needs and what their preferences are moving. So how we're approaching it is really to be innovative all the time, to provide different types of experiences and content and experiment. So one of the things that is so exciting for me is that we get to experiment a lot more. We have to do tests, we have to check what the conversion rates are, and then optimize and pivot. It is always changing. So things that were important a year ago are no longer important now. Things are changing in a constant way. So experimenting is one of the things that most excites me, and that comes back from the needs of our customers and really knowing that they're changing constantly.
I think for sports fans and entertainment event attendees, the most important need right now is safety, and just feeling safe when you come into the building. And as you've seen a lot of brands do, we created an entire safety program in partnership with some of our corporate partners, so Emory and ShareCare. And really just creating these protocols that you could package nicely in a bow and communicate effectively to your fans so that they feel comfortable coming into your building. And we call them the Safety 6 protocols. So all the actions that we're taking to make you feel safe, and all the actions that we expect of you to make you feel safe to come into the building. And that has become an entire marketing campaign for us.
Yeah, and then from my perspective, the needs and desires have changed in the way that more and more people are at home doing research. They're on their phones all the time, 24/7, because we're stuck in this, you know, one little space. We're not as much engaging with people like we used to. So how do we be part of that conversation and help our customers be part of that? So for us, we pivoted more into looking at doing more digital marketing, which we kind of did, but more of our investment was more pure in the showroom, pure more in that B2B space, doing events. And when you can't do events anymore, what do you think of next? So for us was doing targeted social media campaigns that we knew what consumers were might be looking for, and having them go to that location and directing it back to what that B2B location might be. So for us, it was more of knowing that they're doing the research, part of that conversation, and then getting them there to help our customer bring in new customers. So just thinking of a different way, different mindset.
Thank you. And I think all of those things are exciting, and I think that they're here to stay. I mean, from an experimenting standpoint with you, Christina, that you talked about, or the concept of safety is not changing. We know that that will only continue to grow. And I think brands will continue to think about how to make that cool and interesting after we've all heard it for so long. And then most certainly digital marketing is a space that everyone is tapping into. And I know that there'll be more innovations and inventions around digital marketing in the future. Another question before we wrap, and I'll have another follow-up question after that. This is just a general question. Have any of your companies been impacted in a positive or negative way due to the COVID-19 pandemic? And again, I think you all have high-leveled that, but anything to add around just the true impact of the pandemic on your business or organization?
Yeah, from my perspective, right now in the lighting business, people are at home. So they are now adding pools in their backyard. So our pool lighting is going through the roof. Our outdoor lighting is going through the roof because people are at home. So they're thinking of ways to update their space. So yeah, we're doing awesome. And even when I was in the plumbing industry, same thing, people were at home. So they were renovating that kitchen, renovating their bathroom, because now they were looking and saying, oh, what can I do to, I've been putting this off and now's the time. Now I'm home, might as well enjoy it. So yeah, we've been positive. We've had a very positive effect just from, again, people being at home and thinking of ways to update their space.
I think, for us as well, we found a way to turn a negative into a positive, and just thinking about the organization, we've all found a way to get our jobs done from home. And I think that will continue. I think we've all found new ways to collaborate when we're not at the office together. And then for our fans, I think, they miss sports the way it used to be. And I think, we're just excited to move forward and push through this crawl, walk, run approach and finally get to that running stage.
Well, for us, it was, I think, the positive and negative kind of weave together for us, because I think most of the negatives, which was that the industry got really impacted. We were in a situation where we didn't know what was going to happen. It became a fuel for being innovative and to look at the things as we have them, the status quo, and challenge that. And I think that's really important, especially for my standpoint, which is, again, digital brand, and how we can go to market in smarter, better ways, more interactive ways, more complete ways as well. So I think that because we challenged that status quo, I don't think we're going back to that. We're moving forward, as we've mentioned this. And I think that's a good thing. I think positives more than negatives came from COVID-19.
Awesome. I think I've heard that across the board. We've all had to turn a negative into a positive, both professionally and personally. So I know everyone can resonate with that. I actually have two more questions. I think we have enough time. I want to get our audience questions in. So for the new marketers who are tuned in today, this is just a general question. What would be each one of your top things to not do when you're starting off marketing an organization or you're new in the marketing space? What is your top advice for what you shouldn't do when you're starting in marketing?
I think one thing that comes to mind is putting your own personal preferences aside and stepping into your target audience's shoes. Just because you don't like something doesn't mean your target audience won't like it. So that's one thing that comes to mind.
Love that.
Yeah, and to add to that, listening. It's all about learning. When you start, you're learning. You want to basically be a sponge and learn from different parts of the organization, from not just marketing, but from the sales team, because at least from Christine and I's roles, the sales team is extremely valuable because there are eyes and ears out to the customer. So learning from different parts of the organization, because then that helps you to develop maybe that campaign or that promotion or whatever it might be. But the best advice somebody gave me, and I quote her every day, was in order to market something, you got to learn how to sell it. So from my perspective, it's learning from those that are out there and then being able to apply it.
Fantastic. Christina?
I agree. I think the other thing is never stop learning, not only from your, because audience, right? Learn your brand, learn your product, learn your audience. And those will drive a lot of really how you go to market and how you make your marketing potent and important. But I think the other part is never stop learning yourself. So always try to strive to learn a new thing every day. And if you can take courses, if you can get mentors, if you can just really strive to always learn, that will be super helpful. I feel like that is something that I've learned across my career, is to never stop learning, not only for your brand and as a marketer, but for your personal enrichment.
Thank you. Awesome, awesome advice. All right, our final question is, what are the top trends for marketing for the near future in your industry? What do you expect to come next? And again, I think you guys may have touched on this, but what do you think is next? We talked about digital and experimentation and scalability and just moving forward in the digital landscape. So give us a little more detail about what you see.
I think for us, some of the new things that we're working through right now is one, a new social network or way of networking. So with Clubhouse, this concept of audio chat social media. And, you know, whereas social is traditionally like you're pushing out a message and your fan is consuming it by themselves, this allows you to bring your fans into a room with each other and they can all talk to each other. So for us, it's been really learning that space and how to conduct effective conversations in that space, and we're still learning how to do it. And the second thing that we're kind of working through right now is this whole concept of NFTs or non-fungible tokens. And I've learned a lot about NFTs this week, and just trying to wrap my brain around why someone would pay millions of dollars for a little token that they open up and it's like a video of a player doing a dunk or whatever it may be, but they're selling for millions of dollars. So you know, we're really figuring out that space, and the league has put out some new guidelines towards it. So hopefully you'll see the Hawks getting into the NFT space soon.
Very interesting. Anyone else?
For me, I think the difficulty of bringing the tactile into digital. So as I mentioned, because we're working with materials and materials are very much tactile, that transition and making it easy for our customers to see and touch faster, easier, that's going to be where it is. There's a lot of digital tools that we're planning on building to make sure that we are developing the right kind of design support for them. And it is very specific to my industry, obviously, but I think, again, how we go to market through the digital channels and provide more value, that's where the future is for us.
Yeah, and mine's very similar to Christina's, of more of that utilizing the digital channel, thinking more of how do we engage with them through that digital, if it's creating some sort of planner where they can plan out their space and where the lighting affects or how it falls within the space, or if it's some sort of engagement where from a B2B standpoint, you have a building owner walking into a commercial building and seeing the light in the space and being able to tell the story. So it's more about engagement, using those tools to be part of that conversation.
Awesome. Thank you all for that. I know I need to now go do some research on NFTs. And when I'm lighting my house and redesigning, I know the people to tap into. And if I see some cool technology or anyone on the line, we know who it came from. Thank you guys so much for taking the time today. I hope that all of the guests enjoyed it. I'm going to turn it back over to Leanne Touchton from AMA, who's going to close us out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all panelists very much. I'm trying to get my video back up. Here we go. Just so I can say official thank you to Narcisse, Emily, Christina, and Noelle. Thank you so much for moderating this for us. We appreciate everyone who took the time to join us today. This really has been a year of the pivot. And all this insight that you all have shared for us has been extremely helpful. So I hope everyone has a great weekend. Enjoy it from the AMA, and we will see you on our next virtual event. Thanks. Okay.